Hello, guess what? Today's the day. We're gonna get started with our overview through level A. We're gonna do lessons 1 to 4 this week. I know some of you are probably really excited to get started. I know some of you are probably a little overwhelmed to get started. So do me a favor, before we do anything, let's just take a deep breath. Sometimes I get a little overwhelmed or anxious. Deep breath. Yeah. You know what? It's going to be good. You're going to do great. So let's get started with a little bit of housekeeping. This is your teacher's manual. You will need this to go through the overviews. I'm not going to be showing you the pages, but I will be referring to pages and I want you to follow along. I want you to open up to the second page. Now this one I will show you just because I want to make sure you understand. Two things. First is that this book, it says here, the publisher hereby grants permission to reproduce the appendix and practice sheets for a single family's use only. I just want to point that out, that the appendix pages, the practice sheets, you can make copies out of this book. That is legal. Anything else would be not considered legal, so you probably wouldn't want to do it. Second is, look and see when your book was printed. If you just recently purchased a book, it would probably have something like March 2020. And you can see where I have mine, I highlighted it. It's underneath the ISBN. You may have one that is from 2015 or another date, and that's okay. But what I want to point out before we get started with any of these lessons is that if you have a book that's dated previous to March 2020, go on our website at rightstartmath.com, hover over resources, click on teaching support, and then you're going to go down and you'll see where it says corrections and go to level A. And then you can see the dates. So depending on what the date is in your book, and I hope this isn't, I'm trying not to confuse you, but I do want to make sure you understand that if you have a book that is printed older than, say, I have March 2020, you will need to look to see if there are some corrections. And then you just go in and I would find the lessons and I would make the corrections. If your book is dated March 2020, you're good. You won't need to make any corrections. However, just know you might find a mistake. If you do, you can let us know at info@rightstartmath.com and we can fix it. The cool thing is RightStart prints their books in the office. So as mistakes are found, they correct it. And then when they make their new printings, those mistakes have been corrected. Anyway, enough about that. I know you're ready to get going. So let's open up to lesson one. And I'm going to point out, I'm not going to do this every week, but because this is new, a lot of you are probably really new at using RightStart. Level A is the introductory level. So some of you, this is your first time. And those of you that are not, you know, it's okay. It's good to go over these things too. All right. So the objectives. A lot of times we tend to just kind of skim over these. We don't really pay attention. But they're there to let you know, what are we going to be teaching in the lesson? What are we going to go over? So it's a great quick overview to see. And it uses words like we're going to learn, we're going to recognize, we're going to practice, we're going to identify. So just know that. Know that as you're doing the lesson, sometimes we're just going to learn. Doesn't mean we're going to have it mastered. We're just going to practice. Or we're just going to learn to identify. I'm going to let you know what you need for the first 4 lessons. You could put them in a basket. You could put them in a bin. I have a shelf here. Put it in a bag. Whatever floats your boat. You just put your manipulatives in there. Then when it's time for math, you just grab that container. You're ready to go. The first thing it calls for is the music for Yellow is the Sun, and it says it's in appendix, the appendix page 1. So I want to point out that if you bought the book bundle, It came with appendix pages already copied and printed out. But it's not every single one, just the ones that you're going to need more than one copy for. Usually to play the games, and you'll see some of the calendar and some other things we'll be doing with it. There are a few appendix pages that can only be found in the back of your teacher's manual. One of those is the music for Yellow is a Sun. That's not necessary unless you play a musical instrument and you want to play the music as you sing through the words. I don't play a musical instrument. I did not use that, but it's there if you would like to. All right, so another material you're going to need is the Yellow is a Sun book. That looks like this. It's a fun book. You're going to be using this a lot, this level. You're going to need the 1-inch tiles container like this. What makes these important is that these are 1 inch by 1 inch. So if you purchase tiles not through Right Start, make sure, measure them 1 inch by 1 inch, because we're going to actually use these to measure things with. And that's why it's important that they're 1 by 1. Tally sticks are some other materials you need. And yes, they look like popsicle sticks or craft sticks. We're going to be using these. You need about 5. No. Let's do 10. 10, because you're going to be making some patterns using these. In lesson 2, it's going to call for the finger cards from the appendix, page 2. There's 2 sets. You're going to need to cut these. Now, I have a variety of cards here because if you did not get the appendix page, you're going to want to make copies. Now, this is on cardstock, so it's a nice, firmer paper. Notice there's different colors. The finger cards, the dot, the bead, and the tally stick. And it tells you in the book, but I just wanted to point out, you want to make sure you do these in different colors. It will just make it easier when it's time to play the games. So in lesson 3, if you'll look at the materials, you'll see that the last item is bold. Anytime you see something that is in bold print, it means that it did not come in the container or the kit, the Right Start to Math set. This is something that you are going to have in your house and you'll just gather to use for class. So you want to make sure you get something ahead of time. Now, the items you need for this is for sorting. So you can use the tiles that we have here if you want. You can use tiles, Legos. You know, if you have items that your child likes, cars, toy cars, whatever, grab a pile of them and they're going to get to sort. There's ideas in the book too. I think it'd be kind of fun. You can get some socks. You can have the kids sort the socks, get some laundry done. No. But you could do socks if you want, but they'd probably enjoy something like the tiles or the Legos, something with a little bit more color. All right, lesson 4, last lesson of the week. One of the materials you're going to need for that is the multiplication cards. They look like this, with the numbers on the other side are in blue. There's also envelopes that come with these. And the envelopes have the multiples for like the 1, envelope for the 2s, an envelope for the multiples of the 3. What you need to do is you're going to need to separate the cards into these envelopes. Now, if you haven't messed up your cards, you just open them brand new out of the package. They're already correlated so that all you have to do is just put the first 10 into the 1s. Then the next ones, you see the 2s, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. You put that into the 2s and so forth. If you're like me and you've been using these cards and they're all mixed up, you get to separate them and then put them into the envelopes. I apologize. I don't have my envelopes to show you. I lent some items out to a friend, but it's also good to know this is the math card game book. It came in your kit in the appendix page on the back. And this is good to know, because if you do lose your envelopes, you can print this out, cut these each out, glue them or tape them onto an envelope, and then you could put your cards in. Now, something that's kind of funny, I always wondered, why are these numbers, certain numbers, got a square around them? And then I realized, what's the square for 2? 4. What's the square for 7? 49. Yeah. I'm letting you in on that secret now. It took me a couple years before I realized it. All right, so that's it on the objectives and the materials. And so just a little bit of overview for the lessons themselves. We're going to go back to lesson 1. And one of the things I like to point out is you were going to be going through this book, and you're going to be saying the little poem that goes with it. So some of the things that we like to do with my kids is when we get to 4, it says, hear the thunder roar. And we'll do it. We'll say, hear the thunder roar. Here's the mighty 4. And come and make a big deal out of it. Then the last one, ducks will swim and dive. My whole hand makes 5. And then we like to do a high five. So I'll high five with the kids and they think it's fun. And it just brings a little bit more fun to doing this poem. But it helps with understanding and being able to recognize quantities. Because the big word here in these lessons, 1 through 4, is the word subitize. And it's one of those words that's kind of odd. And it's a little awkward to say if you've never really said it before. I've been saying it long enough now that it seems really familiar, but it is kind of funny. It does show you in the book how to say it. It shows the phonetic spelling for subitizing. But basically, all that means is that you're going to be able to see at a glance a certain amount. Most can see about 6 items. So if I took a handful of pennies, let's just say I had 10 pennies, I threw them on the table, and you looked, you would not really be able to tell me just by glancing how many pennies there were. But if I had 4 pennies and I threw them on the table and you had looked down quickly, you could say, oh, there's 4. You could say, oh, there's 5. And if I threw 6, you could probably say there's 6. But after 6, it gets a little, it's hard to be able to see the amount unless you start grouping. So that's what the children are going to be learning to do this week. They're going to learn to see the quantity without counting. Now, does that mean counting is bad? No, it's not. Counting is good. But is counting efficient when it comes to doing addition and subtraction? No, it's not. And I can testify to that personally. I was a finger counter up until I started teaching Right Start to my own children. And I'll be honest, if I get a little sleepy or I'm a little stressed, you'll see me revert back to using my fingers, but then I'll stop. Like, no, 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 I have strategies. It's so much more efficient to be able to see the quantities. And it will help tremendously when we get into starting to add and subtract numbers. So it's really, really important that your children learn to see the quantity without counting. Now, some of you are going to have children who already count, and they're very comfortable with counting. And you're going to see that they're going to want to count when you're doing something. One of the things in the lesson will say, show and have the children tell you how much. You don't want to keep your fingers up long enough that they could sit there and go, 4. You want to do it so it's like, you don't give them a lot of time. Now, if a child does count and you want to pay attention, you can see their head nodding, you can see their mouth moving, say, oh, that's great. Yes, there's 4. And then come back later and say, okay, now, can you tell me how many there are without counting, and do it really quick. Now, I found when I did this with my grandchildren, my granddaughter loved to do that back to me. So she's like, Grandma, how much is this? And I would have to tell her, 2. There's sometimes I would give her the wrong number because I wanted to see if she knew. And that's a good thing. One of the things in our book, in lesson one, it talks about disagreeing and how important it is that we, our children, feel comfortable to disagree with us. So let your children know it is okay. If they think you said something wrong, they can disagree. And there's times when you have to purposely do that in these lessons to make sure that they're understanding what they're doing. Something else you're going to notice in these lessons is at the very end, it says in conclusion. So in conclusion is just kind of a summary of what has been learned. It is an expansion. It's building on. Maybe they have to think a little harder. It's okay if they don't always get the answer correctly. It's really just to get them to think, and you kind of can gauge and see where they're at and how they're doing. So in lesson three, when it talks about sorting, because that's really what the whole lesson is about. If you have a young child who's starting in Right Start, I've heard of children being, you know, 3.5 or 4, which is really young, but some kids are ready for it by then. Start with 2 colors with the sorting versus, you know, here's 4 colors or more colors. Depending on your child and their age, you can have them sort for different ways, different things besides just color. Maybe you have shapes that you can use and you have them, they're colored. Maybe you do it by color the first time. Maybe you do it by shapes the second time. All right. And so for lesson 4, you're going to be working with seeing the quantity up to 5. So the child's going to be working between 4 and 5. You're going to work with helping them see that there's a middle. And so they're going to use tally sticks also when they're, and you know, we do that when we're counting, we do 1, 2, 3, 4, and then we cross out the 5. That's what they're going to be doing in this lesson too. And so the number 5 stick, we have them place horizontal across. A lot of times when we mark it out on a paper, we're going to put it as a diagonal, and that's fine. And if you have a child that insists on putting it as a diagonal, that's fine. But the reason we use horizontal is because it just covers the sticks best. And so that's kind of what they're going to see. Let me show you, I'll show you an example of what I'm talking about. And the tally sticks. So you can see how we put that horizontally across. We did it. We made it through the overview for lessons 1 through 4. I'm excited for you guys to go out there and get started. I'm not sure if you're aware of Right Start's mission statement. It says that we want to help children understand, apply, and enjoy mathematics. And that's what you're getting ready to do. If you have any questions, any concerns, you can contact us at info@rightstartmath.com. And feel free if you want to contact me personally at debbie@rightstartmath.com. You could also call if you want. One of the good things about this manual, you just turn it over. You will see at the bottom information on how to contact us. Until next week.